Hello everyone, and welcome to the first video in my series of videos covering the PHP scripting language. In this video, I want to go over with you basically a little bit about the history of PHP. I'd like to define what PHP is, letting you know generally what it's used for, how it works. We'll need to talk a little bit about the request response cycle, how it was done traditionally with plain HTML files, static HTML files, and then looking at it again and seeing how PHP changes and can affect that request response cycle. And then talking a little bit about exactly what it is PHP can do for us and how it can make it easier for us to develop more full-fledged, interesting websites. So starting off a little bit with the history of PHP. PHP was created in the mid-90s by a gentleman named Ramus Lerdorf, whose name I'm almost certainly mispronouncing, and I apologize to him for that. When PHP was first created, it was created because Mr. Lerdorf, I suppose, wanted to be able to create dynamic web pages for himself, for his own personal website. So originally, PHP stood for personal home page. Later, though, as PHP became more popular, they changed its name so that PHP stood for PHP Hypertext Processor. PHP has become a very popular scripting language, I believe the most popular server-side scripting language. Last time I looked up information about its usage, I believe the statistics were from April 2007, and what I found was that PHP was currently being used at that time on almost 21 million web domains. So a very, very common language in use on the web. What actually is PHP? Well, PHP is called a server-side scripting language. So essentially, PHP is a programming language, a language that can be used for writing programs or scripts, and as they're usually called in this case. And these scripts that are written in PHP are executed on a web server or as a component of a web server. This makes PHP a little different than some other languages that are in common use on the web. JavaScript, for example, is another very common web language. JavaScript, though, executes in a client's web browser, so JavaScript always executes on the client side, which restricts some of the things it's able to do for security reasons. PHP, on the other hand, always executes on a server, which leaves PHP much more free and open to be able to carry out a lot of tasks that JavaScript otherwise couldn't do. So both of them together, JavaScript for the client-side interaction, PHP for the dynamic generation of the page, are two very powerful tools that when used together can be used to create virtually any website you can think of. Okay. So how does PHP actually work? Well, before we dig into the PHP part of it, just talking quickly about how a normal request response cycle works on the web. If you were going to any old website and requesting an HTML file the way most people do many times a day, in the setup, there's of course always the client computer, which is the one that's going to make the request. The client is the one that usually runs the web browser. There's also of course the server, which actually contains the pages, images, CSS file, JavaScript, all of those kinds of things that are being requested. And so that the two can communicate with one another, there is of course the internet. The way it works then is that a request can be sent from the client to the web server. This request is usually sent in response to the client or the person sitting at the client doing something like clicking on a hyperlink, selecting a bookmark, typing in a URL, submitting a form. Any of those different types of things result in a request being sent from the client across the internet to the web server. Now, on the web server, like I mentioned before, there are lots of different files. In this situation, we'd be talking about HTML, JavaScript, CSS, images, those sorts of things. The request that came from the client will be for one of those HTML files, more than likely. So what would happen is when that request gets to the web server would start by locating the HTML file that has been requested. It would then grab that HTML file, and again, using the internet, it would return that file back to the client. When that file actually gets back to the client's browser will read through the HTML file. The HTML file may ask for some additional resources like CSS style sheets, JavaScript scripts, image files. If any of those are asked for, then the browser will do additional requests to also retrieve those files from the server. Once all of the needed resources are gathered, the browser will then render the web page, read through the HTML file as if it were a set of instructions, and draw the web page on the screen for the user, however it is the HTML file has specified that should be done. Overall, that system works just fine. For as complicated as it really is under the hood, it's amazing that it works as well and as fast as it usually does. So how is this entire process then affected by PHP? Where does PHP fit into this request response cycle? Well, the whole thing starts the same way, where the client makes a request to the server, again, clicking a link, submitting a form, however that request gets sent. A request gets sent to the server, but this time, on the server, instead of just having HTML, JavaScript, CSS, and images, the server would also contain PHP files. These PHP files are usually like mini programs, and essentially what these programs do when they're run is they generate web pages. They essentially generate pages that contain HTML, JavaScript, and CSS. So when a request comes into the server for a PHP page, what will happen is the server, which would now also have access to a PHP processor, right, the server would find the PHP script that's been requested. It would hand that off to the processor, which would then execute the script, actually run the program in essence. The output of that would then be HTML. Right? That HTML that's then returned as a result of that program being run, right, would then be treated basically like any static HTML file would, where the web server would then take that file, return it back to the client, and again, the client could make any additional requests that were necessary and would eventually render the page. The user would see the page pop up. What's of course different now is that previously with plain HTML, the page that was requested was simply the page that was requested. It is what it is, and it would always look exactly the same. But now with PHP in the mix, every time the user requests a page, the program that generates that page could potentially generate things that are a little bit different about it. So what appears to be three requests all to one page could actually end up producing three different sets of output. So every time the user requests the page, they may see something a little bit different. All right, so looking at this sort of from a program point of view, and this is of course something we'll talk about a whole lot more in later videos, this is kind of what a little PHP file would look like. You can see that it's primarily just HTML, but inside the body, there is a set of what are called PHP tags, and inside those PHP tags is a PHP statement, the statement that says echo hello world. That particular statement essentially says output the text hello world into this position in the HTML file. If this were the code that had been requested, when it was handed off to the PHP processor and executed, what would result when that program ran would be the output that the program had said to generate. So we would end up with an HTML file with the text hello world in the body. All of the PHP code at that point has been executed out, so none of it remains. All we see is basic valid HTML and its content, and this is the page that would actually then be returned to the browser and that the browser would render. So to the browser, the fact that a PHP file is being requested is insignificant, really. The browser just knows that it makes a request. It doesn't really care so much what kind of page or script that request is for, and the browser knows that what it will get back should be HTML that it can then render. Right? So the browser itself never actually sees any PHP. PHP only lives on the server, and it's only ever really seen by the website's developers. Okay. So how can this actually benefit us, right? Obviously, PHP adds another layer of programming, another layer of complication, if you think of it that way, to the entire development of a web page or a website. Why would we want to bother? What is it that PHP could actually do for us? Well, let's look at a little scenario. Let's say that we wanted to create an online bookstore. Nothing nearly as complicated as Amazon.com or anything like that. Let's just say that I have a large collection of books that I've bought personally. Let's say I have 1,000 of them, right? And what I want to do is I want to sell these books individually, one by one, on a website that I'm going to build. If I was going to do this using traditional HTML, just static HTML pages that were each handwritten, what I would have to create would first of all be a page, essentially a home page, and let's say that that page would just show a list of all 1,000 books that I want to sell. But I also then want there to be a detail page about each book, a page where the user can click on a book on the home page and then see details about that particular book, maybe a picture of it, a description of it, how much I'm charging for it, the condition it's in, details like that. Using static HTML files, what I would then have to do is once I had the home page with the list of all books on it, I would then have to create an individual page for every single book that I wanted to sell. So if I wanted to sell 1,000 books, that would mean that I would have to create 1,000 HTML pages. So overall, this website created this way would end up being 1,001 web pages big. Certainly could be done, although I don't know about you, but creating that many pages doesn't sound like a whole lot of fun to me. There's also, of course, the problem of what would happen if one day I decided I wanted to change the details that were shown on a page, or I wanted to change the design of the site. I would have 1,001 pages that I would have to go through and edit, which would not be a lot of fun. So how could PHP help us out with this? Well, if I were to do this exact same website, basically a home page showing all the books plus a detail page for every book, if I was going to do this with PHP, it would require still that I create the home page. So that part's about the same. But where things would really be different is that with PHP, I would only actually have to create a single page that would then be able to show the contents of all of my books, each individually. Essentially, because PHP can generate pages dynamically, what I could set up would be a system where whenever the user clicks on a book on the home page, an identifier for that book could be passed to the detail page. And since in this situation that detail page is going to be dynamically generated by PHP, PHP could look at the ID that was passed and then could fill in the details of the specific book for that detail page. So instead of having to have a detail page for every book, I would have one detail page that could show the details of any book. This obviously would be a whole lot less work, only having to create two pages instead of over 1,000. It would also, of course, make things a lot easier to manage down the line. If I wanted to change how the pages were displayed, change the design of the pages, it would certainly be a whole lot easier to do that with two pages than it would be with 1,001. Looking again at just a little sample of PHP code talking about how this could be accomplished. This is kind of something like I could put together for my book detail page. What would actually happen here is all of the actual details of the book, instead of being hard-coded into the pages themselves, like with the traditional HTML method, all of the details of the books would actually be kept in a database that my PHP server would have access to. The first three lines that I have there in the PHP code basically connect to this imaginary database in this scenario, select a particular book whose ID we've been given, and then pull that book's details out. The last three lines in the sample code down below then take the title, the description, and the price of those books and actually output it so that it becomes a part of the HTML that will then be returned to the browser. So with something like this, when it actually executed retrieving the details of one specific book, what would actually end up being returned to the client's browser would simply be something along these lines, a simple HTML page that shows the details about the one book that has been requested. So PHP is an extremely powerful tool, lets us accomplish much more ambitious things than we would ever dare to attempt with HTML by itself. And in the next videos, we'll start taking a look at how to actually write PHP code and talking about the basics of how all of this sort of thing can be done.